Hi, welcome to the Berkshire Health Program. I'm your host, Dr. Ed Hornstein. Last show, we talked about some of the changes that are occurring in medicine, and we specifically talked about the formation of accountable care organizations and how we were functioning in that environment to provide the best and integrated care to patients. We're going to expand upon that a little bit tonight. We're going to talk about an initiative in Berkshire County, specifically the Berkshire Fallon Health Collaborative, which is another accountable care organization with the goal of providing integrated care to a patient population at risk. It's our Medicaid population, and we're dedicated to trying to do that well. My guests tonight, and I have three of them, so bear with me. Mike Nicky from Fallon is the Vice President of Mass Health Programs for Fallon, and pretty knowledgeable about this whole topic. He's been helping shepherd us through this process. We've got Dr. Everett Lamb. Dr. Lamb is the medical director for Community Health Program, CHP, and they are an integral partner in what we're doing here. And we have Dr. Tom Consolati. He's an internist in the area, a homeboy, who is a part of our physician health organization and also the head of our clinical integration committee. Guys, welcome.
Thank you.
It's really good having you. So I gave you a little bit of a heads-up warning, right, that the first part of the show would be to have us each tell us a little bit about yourself. So, Mike, hit it.
Sure. Well, as you mentioned, I work for Fallon Health. We're based in Worcester, Massachusetts, and we've been there for about 41 years now. We're a not-for-profit health plan. And at Fallon, I actually work with provider organizations like Berkshire and Community Health Programs to help them build programs to help wrap services around patients that maybe they need that aren't really in the doctor's office. Like things like social work, transportation, and other things to really help them get the care they need when they need it, particularly for folks that are actually getting their health care through the government, whether it be Medicare or Medicaid.
All right. Well, how did you end up getting into this? I mean, so what's the path that brought you here?
Randomness. I actually started my life as a scientist and engineer.
Did you really?
I did, and yeah. I actually worked for many years doing environmental science. And then my career just took a change. I moved back east. I lived in California for many years to be closer to my family for some health issues that my father was having. And then when I was looking for a job, I wound up in healthcare, and it's been about 12 years.
Wow.
Through that path, I've worked on Medicare programs. I've worked on Medicaid programs. And I worked on commercial health insurance for people with low income through the Commonwealth Connector.
So. Yeah. Thanks, Mike. See, it seems like you just came back and you've already been here for a good long stretch,
right? It feels
right?
like a long time, yeah.
Well, we're really glad to have you. We're going to come back to you as we talk about the Berkshire Fallon Health Collaborative and exactly what it is and what it means. Everett, it's your turn in the meantime.
Well, thanks. Thanks for having me. As you know, I'm a relative newcomer to the Berkshires. I've been here now for about a year and a half.
You're a neophyte.
That's exactly right. With community health programs. Community health programs, for the folks who don't know, is a federally qualified health center and really the community health center within the Berkshires. And it's an organization that has grown considerably over the last couple of years, mostly because of the need and the demographics in the county. There are lots of patients and folks with Medicaid and lots of folks with Medicare. The folks in the county are getting older, and we're able to provide care for that population efficiently. CHP started out many years ago. It was a pediatrician by the name of Tom Whitfield who started out in Great Barrington and has expanded from there. We now have 10 sites from Great Barrington in the south up to North Adams in the north. And I'm hoping we'll talk a little more in a couple minutes about how CHP came to join the ACO. Myself, I came from the Seacoast of New Hampshire, where I was a pediatrician, and I'm happy to be here with my family.
Everett, really glad. We're really glad to have you. So again, welcome, and thanks for coming on the show.
Thanks for having me.
All right, homeboy.
So as Ed, again, thank you for having me. But as Ed suggests, I grew up here in Lee, spent my childhood high school in Lee, and then went to medical school at University of Massachusetts. residency down in North Carolina, and then decided 21 years ago now to come back home to practice medicine. And I'm a practicing internist, internal medicine, adult medicine in suburban medical in Lee. Been there for 20 years, the only job I ever had. But in addition to really enjoying and loving taking care of patients, I think because I grew up in this area, I have a dedication to the healthcare system in the county, and I'm very interested in projects like this. I was thinking back though, I do have a connection to CHP. When I was in medical school back in 1991, I did a 1 month rotation at CHP with Dr. Whitfield way back then. So never thought it would come to this. It was a small little practice in an old home at that time. It was kind of fun.
But yeah, a lot of changes in the meantime, right? Yeah.
Absolutely.
We're going to talk a little bit more about how CHP has expanded and how important it is to the community. But Tom, I'm not letting you off the hook yet, right? You wear multiple hats. You are involved in extended care as well in the county?
Right. I as part of the private practice, early on, I got involved in nursing home care, and I really enjoy that. I started out just going to a few nursing homes at the request of the senior partners in my group, but I enjoy it very much. And about 10 years ago, I was asked by the nursing home division of Berkshire Health Systems, called Berkshire Health Care, to start to do some administrative work in the nursing home work. And so now I have approximately a one-day commitment each week to the administrative side of that, and attend in a couple nursing homes as well. So nursing home work has been a love of mine, a big part of my practice for about the last 10 years or so.
So thanks again, guys. I think, you know, there's a sort of a unifying link as we sort of sit across from one another and talk today. And that link is the recognition that we have a population at need that we're all serving. And we recognize that there are multiple ways to serve that community, right? I mean, we have three of us here tonight that are physicians who are also involved administratively, right? And you have to be involved in sort of making decisions and working administratively if you want to make sure that things roll out in a good way. And it's not something a lot of us sort of started out with when we went to medical school. And you didn't start out where you were as you were looking at engineering and, you know, So the changes that are occurring in the healthcare environment are immense, right? And they're evolving very rapidly. Mike, can you tell us a little bit about what this initiative is, what the Berkshire Fallon Health Collaborative is? Where did it come from? You know, what were the roots in the state?
Sure, I think the Medicaid program is very large, and I think most people don't realize that it covers about 1.2 million people in the Commonwealth. So it's a very, very large program. And what Massachusetts has been struggling with is realizing that the program keeps getting bigger and bigger, in part of the dynamics that Dr. Lamb mentioned about aging populations and
right,
other things,
right,
that the program's getting bigger and bigger, but the amount of money in the state budget is not. So the state's starting to try to find creative ways of reducing the cost of healthcare, but they don't want to cut benefits, and they don't want to remove people from the Medicaid rolls because they really don't have another source of coverage.
Yeah, these are people that need care.
Correct. So at the end of the day, that means, well, if there's no more money, what do? And you just get much more efficient about how you do it. And I think in the past, the state realized, and we all experience it today, you have a doctor, you have a pharmacist, you might have a behavioral health specialist, you have an insurance company, you may go to a hospital, but none of them are necessarily tied together. The idea of the ACO, and in one of the slides we show a picture of sort of all our logos together, that's really what an ACO is. It's saying the insurance company, the doctor, the hospital is sort of a blurred line.
Right.
And that we're all working together on sort of one way of doing things, as opposed to someone saying, my insurance company said no, now what do I do?
Yeah.
That really shouldn't happen as much. It really becomes down to, we all know what's going on and we're all singing off the same page in the choir book, and that's really the goal of an ACO. Is we're all coordinated together, all doing the same thing, and we're not actually competing against one another.
No, and I think it's such a good point. We want to talk a little bit, too, about how some of this is driven by the federal government, right, and including how the state is responding to that, because the cost of care is becoming crazy, right?
Correct.
It's escalating and growing beyond that of almost any other segment of society.
Correct.
And if it's allowed to continue that way, it's just not affordable.
Correct.
That just can't continue.
The state budget approximately, depending on how you count it, anywhere from 35% to 38% of the state budget is spent on health care of some sort.
Right.
So,
right.
And that's not atypical of other states, but you realize every dollar spent there isn't available for something else, schools, roads, job training programs.
Right.
So it really becomes an issue of we have to provide health care. It's essential. So how do we do it in the best possible way and get best outcomes?
Yeah.
I think a lot of folks, we've all had personal experiences in the healthcare system.
Yeah, where
sometimes you're like, well, right. I went to a doctor and I said, I go to Dr. Hornstein, it's my primary care doctor, and I get a whole bunch of blood tests. And he goes, you need to see a specialist, and he runs a whole bunch of tests again. And I get two x-rays, and as a patient,
right.
that's distressing.
Right.
There's a lot of being poked.
It can be two of the same x-ray. Right.
But it also means for healthcare system, we're paying double.
Right.
And really not getting a lot
right.
for it. And this is really trying to get away from that, because now the specialist and the PCP will have the same data.
Yeah.
And they'll, you know, it saves right. everybody a lot of, not just expense, but as a patient, you really want to have the least invasive procedures. And you don't want to be poked. And I know I don't like to see my doctor that often.
No, really. I think that's...
Because everybody's busy in life.
Right.
And,
right.
You know, the more we can kind of reduce that burden for people, the better. And the
yeah.
more money we'll save.
No, and I think it's, and again, and the docs here, you know, tonight can attest to, I think, you know, we have these sort of terms, right? We talk about siloed care, right? Somebody being seen by their primary doc, they're getting good care, you know, through their primary doc. They're seeing a specialist, they're getting good care through that specialist.
Mm-hmm.
They may come into the hospital, they're getting good care in the hospital. But that transitioning of care, the coordination of care, has typically been an area that we haven't done very well.
Correct.
And because of that, and that lack of coordination, there's often redundancy, repetition of testing. If handoffs don't occur in the right way, after hospitalization care may not be done correctly. The patient doesn't get what they need in the pharmacy. They don't have good follow-up. They end up back in the institution
Correct.
Or in their doctor's office, and the doctor doesn't know what's going on with them. So this just has, we've done good siloed care, and we've not been so good at that coordinated care.
Correct.
You know, so, and Everett, let's shift to you a little bit if we could. So CHP has focused, I mean, you have an array of specialty providers in addition to primary care providers. This is a nice time, I think. You know, you talk about how the roots of CHP, how it started in the area, small, mm-hmm. you know, how it provided care. You guys I've got quite a few care providers now and are taking care of a large population of patients.
We do, and I think it speaks a little bit to what Mike was just talking about in that the expense of care has continued to increase. Medical economics it's very difficult for private practices to survive in the current landscape. And when we talk about patients with Medicaid and Medicare and some of the other insurances, there really is a bit of a void. And so that's where the Federally Qualified Health Center fills that role for folks who have typically government-sponsored insurance programs. And so there was nobody at CHP behind the scenes masterminding some growth, but it was really out of the necessity because Berkshire County has this wealth of phenomenal health care and these phenomenal practices that have been around for years and years, but are just having a bit of a difficult time
yeah.
because the economics are impossible. I think that when CHP was smaller and really self-contained, there was some limited interaction with the medical center. But now that there are labs in all of our sites and,
right.
and we all in the county use the same radiology services and the same emergency departments,
right.
it just seems natural that we all start working together, and that's Berkshire Health Systems and CHP and practices like yours, Tom, that we all now come together because I think that Berkshire County is really, it's a unique place.
Right.
And it's really a chance for all of us together to build a healthcare system that we can be really proud of.
Yeah, it's almost an ideal test tube, right? I mean, the
yeah.
geographic positioning of Berkshire County places us in a position of being able to potentially be better able to coordinate care than other people may find
Absolutely.
In place, including that they're closer together, for example, in the city of Boston,
mm-hmm.
where you do have competing
Correct.
Large health systems
right.
who aren't really interested in coordinating care among themselves. They're looking to do well themselves,
mm-hmm.
right? And here, I think, in the county, we have a unique opportunity to handle this sort of defined population.
And if I can just add, even though there's a defined population, there still aren't necessarily enough providers to take care of all of the patients who are here. Yeah. So there certainly is really very little competition between the practices that are here. There's plenty of medicine to go around. So I think everybody feels good about being able to play their part in now this larger organization we're putting together.
Yeah, I think that's an interesting point too, Everett, that that the inability, you know, there's a relative lack of providers. And so part of what we would look at as we're trying to coordinate care and do this better are other strategies that might allow us to better reach out to patients and make sure that they're involved in the or receive the care that they need. And we're going to have some pretty dynamic options as to how to do that, and that may include things like Teledoc, you know, sort of consultative care done, you know, with a person still in their home, you know, those types of things. And Tom, as a primary care doc, as an internist, part of your strategy over time has been to do just that, right? We talk about the medical home model, right? Being able to provide patients with the best care and help them and make them a part of their care decisions.
Yeah, I think as a primary care doctor, there's a couple things that are really exciting about this. First of all, this organization is named, I think, very aptly a collaborative. And we've all been in situations in healthcare where the insurance won't pay for this. I have to get it through your insurance. This is the first time in my 20 years where I've really felt like the insurance side of things is a true partner and the organization is a collaborative. And what that does, to your point, is it brings a lot of creative thinking and a lot of resources. And especially as a primary care private physician, in the past, if I had issues that required a community health worker or a social worker or even a nurse case manager, my ability to access those people was limited. And what this collaborative does is bring those resources in, because we all know they're necessary. Getting, making a diagnosis and prescribing a medication is one thing, but then there's the whole other part of the patient's life that affects how well they're going to do. And this collaborative allows us to bring in a lot of other resources that as a private physician, I really couldn't access or didn't have a way to really develop in my own practice. So the relationship as well as the resources that it brings, and being at the same table, putting our heads together and thinking about how to best solve the problems our patients have together is truly exciting, and I think will make a big difference in the future.
It's a really neat thing to hear you talk about, because you're nailing it, right? And as we sit, it's what you see, what our viewing audience may see with us sitting here right now, is really what's being recapitulated almost on a daily basis as a part of the collaborative, right? We have the care providers, we have the administrative side, we have the insurer working together to try to figure out the best way to provide care to this population in need. And that includes identifying people in the population who are eligible for care who have never reached out for it, but who really may be in need of it. So it's, like you said, Tom, in the first time in 20 plus years that you've been here, there's a different dynamic occurring here, right?
Yeah, there really is. It's exciting. We have, everyone knows if you come to see your primary care provider, they can look in the record or look in the computer and see if your cholesterol has been done. But I don't have a way to tell which of my patients may not have had a cholesterol done. But even more importantly, I don't have a way to know which patients really need their cholesterol to be done that haven't had it done. And some of the information technology that this project brings will allow us to do that. But then the next step is, if they haven't taken their cholesterol medicine or haven't come in, why? And how can we help them get to us, get their cholesterol checked, get their medication taken? And this organization is really going to help all of those steps, which before I was concerned with prescribing a pill.
Right.
You know.
Tom, you're in a position of being the chairman of our Clinical Integration and Quality Committee, and that's of the physician hospital organization that we have. you've been involved in the development of that organization from its initial sort of pieces. So this has been ongoing now for the better part of a couple of years now. Can you tell us a little bit about the PHO, just to, again, give our audience an understanding of what that does? And then I think we want to shift back to talking about the Berkshire Fallon Health Collaborative and what the state has done to incentivize those of us who are willing to form an accountable care organization and make it work. So a little bit about the PHO first, Tom.
So the PHO, just very basic, PHO stands for Physician Hospital Organization. So this is truly a legal entity that links the hospital with the physicians in the county. And there are basically two types of physicians in the county, those that are employed by the hospital and those that are in private practice. So here we have an organization where we've all come together. We've formed a legal entity with bylaws and with financial rules. And we sit together at least monthly as a group and also in various subcommittees to try to figure out how to break down the walls of the silos, how to make care better for all of our patients. And at the table, we have very high level administrative people from the hospital, financial people from the hospital, several specialists, most of the specialty groups are represented, and numerous primary care doctors, all at the same table, all on equal footing, all with an equal stake in the game to try to work together to make things work well for patients, work well for physicians, and work well for the hospital, which again, in the 20 years I've been here, is unprecedented. It was always this little bit of a power struggle of whose turf was what and who was doing what. But this is truly an organization that comes together with the same goals in mind, and that is to make healthcare in general better in Berkshire County.
Yeah, it's specifically for the individual and the community that we serve, right?
Yeah, yeah.
While at the same time making it sustainable and being able to continue to attract good people into the area.
Right. We need good physicians in the area, so that the landscape has to be attractive. We need a solid hospital, so they have to survive well, and we need to take good care of our patients. We all understand that, and that's what we're all working for.
You know, one of the pieces, as you talked about it, and you and I came, you're here forever, but we came into practice at about the same time in this area. And in the time that we've been here in the past 20 years, the information technologies, the reliance on them has grown by leaps and bounds. And our involvement with an electronic health record has really changed how we interact as physicians and provide care to patients as well. So maybe a comment on that and how that's changed things.
I think that's one major quantum leap that the Berkshire County healthcare landscape has achieved in the last 4 or 5 years that I think probably is completely underappreciated by our patients. And credit Berkshire Medical Center for taking the lead in this and really making it happen. But about 5 or 6 years ago, there has been a push towards an electronic medical record. And there was a choice at that time. Each practice, each entity could have developed its own electronic medical record, which would have fulfilled requirements of insurance companies and the government. But the hospital really stepped in and said, let's do this together. Let's create and develop an electronic medical record that links the hospital and the specialists and the primary care docs, as well as other organizations like the VNA, so that now you really, as a patient, have a medical record. And if you see a specialist, that specialist can see my notes, any tests that I've done. If you're in the hospital and tests get done, they're automatically populated in the medical record. If your specialist changes a medication, it's changed up in the cloud somewhere, and it's changed on my medication list as well. So there's no longer trying to figure out, did you have that test done? If so, where was it? Who ordered it? I'd call my nurse, try to figure out what test that was, when it was done, where it was done, get me the result. It's all there. It makes, number one, our visits much more efficient, but more importantly, it makes decision making much better, much more accurate, and communication amongst us is quite frankly seamless. We're all on the same platform, looking at the same information at the same time. And it's really revolutionized, I think, the way we all interact with each other.
I mean, we still have community practices, and CHP, for example, has a different electronic health record than Berkshire Health Systems does, and there are private practices in the community that have their own. But there's also been a real drive from the health systems to utilize sort of other technologies to link those different records so we still can share that data. It's not seamless. There's a continued move to trying to make the, you know, those shared, you know, divergent medical records blend more easily, but it's happening, and there's a lot of dedication to trying to do that.
Yeah, again, credit the hospital for championing that, and it's difficult, complicated, expensive technology that is doing that, but it's really working.
And we get back to you, Mike, and as we talk about this, actually this might be a good time for me to take a break and reintroduce the show. For those of you watching, you're watching the Berkshire Health Program. I'm your host, Dr. Ed Hornstein. We're talking tonight about the Berkshire Fallon Health Collaborative, which is an accountable care organization whose purpose it is to integrate care and provide care in a coordinated fashion for patients at need. Specifically, the Berkshire Fallon Health Collaborative is focused on bringing coordinated care to our Medicaid population. My guests tonight are Mike Nicky. Mike Nicky is the Vice President of State Medical Services or Programs. Dr. Everett Lamb is a pediatrician and the Medical Director of Community Health Programs, CHP. And Tom Consolati, Dr. Consolati, is, like we said, he's a homeboy. He's an internist, come back home. He's the chairman of our clinical integration committee and involved in a lot of other levels of providing medical care. So again, guys, welcome. Thank you. So Mike, as we talk about this, you know, one of the things, and you get an inkling of it from Dr. Consolati, from Tom, who's talked about how part of how we've started to better integrate care is the development of this electronic health record, but we still have problems, as I alluded to. Mm-hmm. And so as we're trying to figure out how to provide better care, coordinate that care, there has to be investments, right?
Sure.
There's no way that we can just say, okay, we've decided to do it, let's go, right? So, and the state has recognized that there has to be an investment in this process in order for us to succeed. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Sure. So part of this effort, it's really a five-year project.
Right.
And we're actually in what's called year zero. So it's really a six-year project. And I mentioned before how much of the state budget is paid, you know, is really going towards healthcare services. What's important to realize though is the federal government actually pays about half of that.
Right.
So the federal government also cares an awful lot about what happens in Massachusetts. So
they want to bend that cost curve
correct.
Too, right?
So to try to encourage the formation of these ACOs, the federal government has allocated $1.8 billion to the provider systems in Massachusetts
over
the next 5 years.
No,
it's not. It's a very large amount of money to really invest in IT infrastructure and staff and personnel like community health workers, that Dr. Consolati mentioned, or behavioral health programs or other things that today, quite honestly, aren't really covered by insurance.
Yeah, or poorly covered, right?
Yeah. Insurance usually is good for paying a doctor when they have a visit, but they're not really paying for the medical record system.
Right, we talk about the fee-for-service, right?
Correct.
You're getting paid for that, but that's it.
You're getting paid for a service, not for anything else. You know, we're paying for your time, but we're not paying for, well, you need rent. And as Dr. Lamb mentioned, there's a lot of great practices in the Berkshire, but the economics are really challenging for them to stay open. And none of those programs really reflect that today. So the government is actually giving out money to these different ACOs to do it. What's interesting about that is they're allowing the ACOs to decide on how they spend that money. So several people, actually including people here with me in this, today, actually are working with the rest of the folks at Berkshire to say, where are we going to put that money? And some of that is going into IT infrastructure and making all those different systems talk. It also allows the data that Fallon has to get back into your medical records at some point. So today, Dr. Lamb may provide an office visit and a prescription, but he has no way of knowing if that person's ever filled that script or if someone's actually going to a behavioral health doctor or what if they had an emergency in Springfield Right. And then follow
did they
up
show
care.
Up someplace else?
It can
right?
take months for that data right. to get back, right. where Fallon will have that data really quickly. So we're using money to actually build out that infrastructure so doctors actually have the ability to get the full sense of what's going on with their patients, and then to put services behind the primary care doctors. So if they say, hey, you know, this person's really struggling, can you help getting them connected with heating oil assistance, with transportation?
Nutritional needs,
nutritional needs.
Right.
I actually think they really need some behavioral health assistance.
Right.
These are all the things that we can do, or I have a child that's really struggling with asthma, can we get a health educator in the home?
Right.
Now there's a place for the doctors to go, and that's all really basically being paid for by the state and federal government.
Yes, we talk about that, Mike, and so that's got its name, DSRIP, right? Mm-hmm. But that funding, it's interesting the way it's done. We're in fiscal year zero, yeah. which is going to last for about two more weeks, right? And then we're in year one in this five-year plan, but the funding diminishes over time.
It does.
So part of the plan that the federal government and state government has is to say, hey, you guys, figure out how to build this structure that will be efficient and can carry on as this money
that's
wanes,
correct.
Right? So that's part of the plan, and it's as a part of telling the state what's going to happen with the money, you have to have a plan that you present to them, a five-year business plan that makes
correct.
Sense.
You're right, Dan, it has to be approved.
Yeah, it has to be approved.
By both the state and the federal government, because
right.
they really want to, $1.8 billion doesn't come along very often.
No.
So when it does, everyone really wants to make sure it's being spent on the right things.
Yeah.
And that the money is only going to people who are really committed to actually making this transition away from sort of just paying for things as they come.
Yeah.
We kind of pay for healthcare like we pay for groceries. You kind of scan an item, and at the end of the day, you get a bill.
Right.
They're really trying to move people to a budget and say, okay, the collaborative, we're giving you this amount of money to manage care.
For this many people.
For this many people.
Right.
And do it the best way you think.
Right.
And you can have your own rules, your own way of doing it, but at the end of the day, you got to make it work.
Right.
And we want you to make it work. Tell us how you need to make it work. And as you folks have all mentioned, you know, Berkshire County has a unique geography. You really have one hospital,
right.
or one hospital
one
organization,
system.
One
right.
system.
Yeah.
So your doctors have always been informally connected even before the PHO. But it's also an area with challenging demographics and aging population.
Right.
And you are removed from other parts of the state. There's
yeah.
some blessings in that.
Yeah.
You all know
yeah.
each other very
right.
well and work well together.
Yep.
But that also means that there's a greater desire to actually perform and get this to work. At Fallon, I can say, and I've talked to many providers around the state, I'm working with providers around the state, but it's always been very clear to us there's a difference here, and that there's a real strong desire, not only as clinicians, but also as the largest employers in the county.
Right.
In a real sense that you know, this is your home.
Right.
You know, so that's something I think everyone's determined to make this money count.
I think we all have that sense. Everybody that is here is, when we talk about how to provide health care, we recognize that the decisions that we make, the initiatives that we pursue, aren't just theoretical, right? They end up applying to us, to our families, our friends and neighbors, and we answer to them. We'll see them regularly. So there's an additional emotional level in the desire to provide good care here in the community, separate from what all doctors and providers want to do. It really drives it on a little bit of a different level.
As Mike talks about the difference, I think the difference is that people are recognizing is for years, even for patients who had insurance, you had the doctor systems, you had the hospital systems, and the money typically flowed out beyond those systems into the insurance companies, and people were very skeptical for years.
Right.
Fallon has invested in our community. Fallon has not had a large presence prior to this in the Berkshires. But for the first time, they said, hey, wait, we think that there's something there. We think that there's a system that we can make work. And I think everybody's feeling that support as we sit around the table, because how often do physicians and hospital systems sit at the table with the insurers talking about, hey, let's figure out how to invest in your population. So this really is a difference
as usual. And this isn't a one-time piece. This is an ongoing, right. again, we keep going, Tom, you went back to that word. This is a collaborative effort, right? And we've named this the Berkshire Fallon Health Collaborative. I actually think, Leah came up mm-hmm. with that. And I think it really reflects it very nicely what we're trying to do. We're trying to collaborate to provide best care. Everett, you've been working on the Model of Care Committee with members of Fallon, as well as the health system, CHP. Mm-hmm. And part of what that Model of Care Committee has been doing is trying to figure out how we're going to deliver care out into the community in a way that coordinates it, right? And so part of what's coming forward is the development of these care pods. Can you tell our audience a little bit about this?
Absolutely. Care pods. Well, if I could just step back and talk a little bit about in the federally qualified health center world, we have family services, and those family services traditionally have supplied the Women, Infants, and Children's Program. They run food banks. They help folks who have needed some behavioral health care, and they go out in the community. So one of the pieces of the Accountable Care Organization is building this care coordination now throughout the county. And so in this integrated effort, there are going to be these teams, and these teams are made up of nurses and social workers and community health workers who can literally visit patients in their homes and some support personnel. And they're going to be the individuals who will help to bridge the gap between your office, our offices, the offices you work in, so that when patients do have needs or have been hospitalized or have behavioral health needs, they're going to be the folks who can actually reach out daily. And so what's been happening behind the scenes is, and really it's been, there's been a group at the medical center who has really spirited this, that has put together now four teams. They're going to be located throughout the county.
Right.
There's going to be a team in South County, and it's a privilege for CHP to be hosting them in one of our facilities that's going to have those folks. There are going to be two teams in the central part of the county because that's, again, where the population base is. And then there's going to be another team up in the northern part of the county in North Adams. But they really have hopes of getting to patients or members throughout the county and be able to provide folks with what they need. We know that transportation is a challenge in the county.
Right.
And so rather than insisting that all of the patients are now coming to us, we think we can meet them. We also think these coordination teams will be able to meet patients in the emergency department when they're having crises that otherwise would manifest in you're seen in the emergency department, you go home, you need to wait until the offices are open. So we think that that gap is going to be bridged.
And we'll use information technologies to let us know when a member.
That's right.
I'm so glad that you sort of corrected and used that term. We said patients, we're used to saying that, and you said member.
Mm-hmm.
And it's really an important thing to characterize, right?
I think patients are going to be partners with us in this new in this new world order. And that we'll be able to go beyond just writing prescriptions and really being able to look at the whole patient. As we look at in our community, the Breen Center has been instrumental in providing lots of behavioral health services, and they will be partnering with us in this venture as well. And this is going to help to bridge the gap from the medical and the behavioral health side and the social needs and all of those other services that we're talking about. So it really is an exciting venture. And again, Berkshire County really is a microcosm. So compared to other locations, we're hoping that we can pull this off hopefully better and quicker than other places that are struggling.
I go back, Mike, and I think about what you're talking about, how, you know, the federal government has given money up front. The state has provided this money and has distributed it throughout the accountable care organizations in the state. But it's really like there are an array of test tubes in
Correct.
The state right now, right? And nobody knows exactly what the right sort of formula is going to be. So
Correct.
So as these ACOs, these accountable care organizations, are formed throughout the state, there's going to be vigilance and oversight from the state and federal government as to, hey, did these guys do it in a way that really worked? And if not, what needed to happen differently, right? What did we learn from what was attempted here but didn't work? Would
correct.
It have worked with a little bit of, you know? So, you know, I find it interesting. I think you're involved in our accountable care
That's
organization as a partner, but you're also involved in other accountable care organizations.
We're working with two other organizations,
right.
one in central Massachusetts
yeah.
and one in eastern Mass, and they look very different.
Yeah, right.
They have very different
personalities.
Too,
right?
We find with our ACO out here, for example, English is the primary language. The vast majority of the patient base, not all, but a majority. Our ACO in Eastern Massachusetts, our website is in six languages. They give you a sense of sort of the difference in the dynamics, because it's a very different population mix. We work with another health center as well in Eastern Mass, and then we work with a provider group that actually founded Fallon. There was actually a Dr. Fallon.
Yeah,
so
right.
The Fallon Health was founded by a physician who actually started the first specialty medical group back in 1930 in Central Mass. He had the idea of, well, maybe we need specialists and primary care doctors together. And at one point, Fallon actually was partnered with St. Vincent's Medical Center, the Fallon Clinic, which is now Reliant Medical Group, in our health plan,
wow.
to kind of work this out. So this is sort of in our DNA to work with providers on these kind of sort of complex problems. So that's what we're trying to replicate here.
Yeah.
And even we find the needs are very different in different parts of the state. For example, in Eastern Mass, transportation isn't as much of an issue.
Yeah.
Especially in the Boston area, where you have the T and you have other things.
Right.
Where in this part of the state, you have a lot of folks really struggle getting to a doctor, even if they want to get there.
Yeah.
There isn't a great way. So that's a problem we need to address.
Right. Mass transit is not sufficient. Right, right.
So those are the kinds of things you see these differences in. You know, a lot of it is trial and error. There are things we will try that may not work. And that's actually the nice thing about the money that the government's giving is, you know, if you're going into it with a good concept and it doesn't work, they kind of want to know that too.
Yeah, right.
Because they really want to know what works. And there are 17 ACOs across the state. And what the government is going to do is, as we go along, they're sharing the results of sort of what's working here and what's not working.
Well, it's a perfect way to do it, isn't it? I mean, okay, we've rolled this out. Here's what's happening.
Correct.
We don't need to recapitulate and keep pushing on when we have a program that's not working.
Correct.
What is working?
Yep.
How do we change it? How do we modify it?
Well, right? And likewise, I think the state has been engaged at a very different level than they have in the past as well.
I agree, Everett, right?
And that's also encouraging that they're coming to the table, and it's not just pushing down what needs to be done. There really are these productive conversations in terms of what do we think our needs are, what are the finances available? And so I do think that it's interesting that this is going to continue to change and evolve based upon what we experience.
Yeah, I think that one of the very exciting things about this is essentially everything that's happening is homegrown. This is our medical community working with our insurance partner trying to figure out what we need. And people from the hospital, patients in the group, we have physicians, specialists, primary care doctors. And so, you know, we think anyway that we know best what we need and we can work it out. And the state's letting us do that. And, you know, that's exciting. This is not something being forced upon us.
Tom, I think, and again, I go back to it, it was an important piece to hear what you mentioned, which is that patients are involved in the process. Members are involved in the process, right? So, and it's one thing for us to sit in position and say, oh, here's how we think it should be done. This is how we think it should work. It's another thing entirely if you're the recipient of, you know, the benefits and care being offered to say, wait a second, here's what I ran into as a problem. Or this worked fine, but when I tried to get my child in through the door here, this is what I ran into. Or we needed to get out of, you know, we needed care that wasn't available locally in the community, and we ran into this when we were trying to get specialty care in Springfield or Boston, you know. And so it's going to be really important for our members to tell us that so we can figure ways around it, how to fix it, how to attend to it.
Well, it's helped us to think about what expanded hours we need and how we can really start meeting the needs. And where your office may be providing some extra hours at this particular time and our offices may be providing at this time, or we're providing pediatrics, you're providing for some of the more adult members in the community. And again, I don't think those conversations have taken place. And we're just thinking about, okay, what are the hospital's urgent care services? Where are they located? And again, it's everybody coming to the table and having that conversation that it's not just one part of the health system making that decision saying, okay, we're opening our office. No, we're actually figuring out where are the resources, where do they live, and where do the patients need them?
Right.
Don't forget also that in most of the groups that are creating these programs, there's also nurses and social workers. What better group of people to really give us a little reality check of what's going on the ground than nurses and community health workers and mental health workers? All of those people are really dramatically part of the whole process from the beginning.
And we've also involved our office managers, who
office
are involved in the day-to-day running of the practices, dealing with sort of the administrative pieces of it, and looked for their expertise and insights as well.
Well, you asked about the Model of Care Committee and the masterminds behind the committee. Yeah. It really is, it's just the folks we're talking about.
Right.
It is the practice managers, it's the nurses, it's the medical assistants, it's all of the folks who are providing the real day-to-day care and logistics. And again, the ideas that are coming out of their meetings, it's inspiring, and we're all hoping it's going
to
work.
You know, I just have to say, and I just feel, as I've been a part of this, I just feel really, I'm enthusiastic and I'm honored to work with the people that I work with. There's some really dedicated, hardworking, really caring people that are working to make this, you know, come to fruition. It's pretty cool. So,
it's very cool, and you really feel the goal and the purpose is selfless. It's to improve the care of in the community.
Right.
You really feel that in essentially every interaction we have. It's fun.
I absolutely agree.
Yeah.
Mike, I think it's important, right? Because we've got, believe it or not, about 10 minutes left in the show. And so, you know, we've talked about what this collaborative is, you know, how we've named it, where it came from, how it sprung up, you know, what the funding was from the state. But we should talk a little bit about some nuts and bolts,
sure.
Right? So Medicaid members in our region, well, across the state, but specifically with our ACO, our Accountable Care Organization, are going to be getting notifications, if they haven't already, about here's what's going to happen.
Yep.
And they're going to see a new healthcare card. They're going to have, so tell us a little bit, tell our audience what they might expect and should expect in the near future.
Sure. If you haven't been opening your mail, I
recommend
people, if you're like me, I wait. But if you look at on the screen, you'll see there's the towns in blue. That really makes up the area that the collaborative covers.
Right. Yeah.
So if you live in one of those towns and you're on Medicaid, but you're not a senior, so I want to be very, elders are not included in this program. It's ages below 65 from birth to 64, and 364 days are the eligible population for this. You're likely going to get a letter from MassHealth with a green stripe on it.
Pay attention to that
letter.
Right.
What MassHealth is essentially doing across the state, but here in Berkshire County in particular, saying if you go to Dr. Consolati, Dr. Lamb, Dr. Hornstein, or a number of other doctors, we're assuming when this ACO launches on March 1st, so only really
a couple of weeks away, a week and a half away,
that you want to keep your doctor.
Right.
You like your doctor. We know you're going to your doctor. So we know that these three doctors and many others are working with the collaborative. So we're going to send you to Fallon to be a member there. So MassHealth is sending a letter to you to let you know that. We will also, at Fallon, we've been sending out all kinds of letters, also kind of explaining what this is, what it means, who to call if you need assistance. There is no shortage of letters and materials, and it's really because it's a big change.
Hold on to them, right? I mean, these are...
Absolutely.
Yeah, but you're also going to give us a site where if you don't hold on to the paper, you can actually get
through
it in a different way.
And you don't open your mail.
Right.
The website is actually live today, just fallonhealth.org/berkshires.
Well, that was handy.
It's the website just for this ACO.
Right.
So all the information's here. If you're wondering if your doctor is in the network, if you go to this site, it will only pull up the doctors in the collaborative. It doesn't pull up our doctors that are outside. You don't need to know the name of anything. You could just say, is Dr. Smith in the network? And it will tell you, which is nice.
So if you go to Fallon's website, you're going to typically going to reach a landing page, which is going to give you a variety of options. And I assume on that landing page, it's going to be, you'll look for Berkshire.
It says MassHealth,
right?
And they'll say, are you a Berkshire Health member?
Okay,
are you
good.
In Central Mass?
Good,
and
good,
are you
good.
A Reliant member?
Right.
And it will direct you to the website. Also, for folks, I'll put the phone number up here, and again, the website, and you're more than welcome to call. But very important for folks that today get care at one of the providers.
Mike,
that
can,
are
you go back,
the collaborative.
Can you go back to the phone number just again for a second? You know, so for our audience, you know, this, if you've got a pen or a pencil, write this down. But again, you'll have that phone number on the website,
correct.
Available through the website.
Correct.
Right? Yep.
Correct.
Okay.
And that number will ring at Fallon and Worcester.
Okay.
We answer our own phones.
Right.
It's our own staff.
It's not India.
It's not India. It's okay. Here. It's here in Worcester. It's in Worcester,
okay.
Where we all work,
yeah.
At Fallon. And when you're there, you dial in. It's actually folks who are specially assigned to your ACO.
Perfect.
So that they start to build up, because they'll start to hear Dr. Lamb, Dr. Consolati. And those know.
Right.
You know, they can actually answer the questions. Time goes on, they get faster and faster and more responsive. They know the towns in the service area after a while.
Yeah, we can imagine this is going to be a little sticky up front, right? Inevitably going to be a bit sticky.
And that's what I was thinking I wanted to move on to. What's important for folks to know is we've actually been mailing out your ID cards. If you have another health plan and you're no longer on that plan, and if you go to the pharmacy on March 1st or you try to go to the doctor, the computer system's going to say
you don't have insurance. Right.
So it's very important that you look in your mail if you see something from Fallon, feel it. You can tell which one's got the card in it.
Right.
And that's your new card. Your PCP is the same. We're going to pay for your services the same. You don't need to worry about it. Whatever prescriptions you have will get filled.
They're going to get carried over. And just again, we know in working with the pharmacy folks and the like, including with referrals, people are currently getting care out of this area.
Correct.
There's a real desire to make that occur seamlessly, right?
Correct.
I mean, at least up front, make sure that whatever's happening now continues to happen and that things can be then addressed as
Correct.
It moves on.
So for folks, that if you have a procedure on sometime in March and you're worried about it, the answer is you don't need to do anything except go to your procedure and get your treatment.
Bring your card.
Bring your card. Because otherwise, the card will make your life a lot easier. But we're committed to making the transition. It's very important to us at the collaborative on both sides. There's a period of time that we have to allow for that. And the collaborative, I'm happy to say, tripled that amount of time. And that was a decision we made as an organization to give patients and providers more time.
No, again, very
friendly.
Because
we take it very seriously that we don't want someone to say, it took me several weeks to get this appointment with a specialist in Springfield or Boston. Now what do I do?
Right.
Well, go to the visit.
Right.
That's what you need to do.
Now, with the card, there's going to be, I understand, an electronic equivalent
Correct.
Of that card. So people will essentially be able to have the card on cell phone and the like.
If you have an Android or iPhone, we have plastic cards for those of you who like it in your wallet. It makes you feel good. And some people really love cards.
Yep.
But the digital card, it's an app. You can download from the App Store from Apple or from the Google Store. And once you type in your card once, your member number, all you need to do is type in your zip code to bring up the card every time. So you don't need to remember a password. Once you do it once, you're good.
Yeah.
And it will pull it right up and it will pull up family members' cards as well.
Awesome.
So it's a really handy way of being able to just show it at the pharmacy or show it to your doctor.
It's your show. You get to ask the questions. But
please.
While we have Mike with us, in addition to the cards coming to patients, there's going to be an outreach. And Fallon is going to try
That's
to help
really
all
good,
of us right. understand a little bit more about the health needs of the folks who have who are in the cooperative, the collaborative. Can you talk a little bit about what folks can expect if they should get phone calls?
Sure.
Yeah, because there's a plan, right? And I'm glad you brought that up. The phone calls are going to be starting March 1st.
Correct.
To try to touch base with
every member.
Right.
So we actually have, and again, it's not a computer that will call you. It's live folks in Worcester who actually call. And what we try to really do is reach out and say, hi, you probably don't know who we are. We want to explain what's going
on. Don't
hang
up on us.
we'll probably ask you if you've gotten your card or a mailing. Right. And if the answer is no, the first thing that we're going to do is send you another one so you know. We also check to say, hey, we see that your doctor, is this the doctor that you see? To make sure. We try to answer those questions like, what do I do if? Can I go to the pharmacy? What do I need to do if I can't find my card and I'm out of medication? We try to do that. We also, to Dr. Lamb's question, start to ask you questions like, hey, like, is there anything we need to know right away? You know, like, are you on dialysis? Or there's something going on?
Are you receiving chemotherapy?
Are you receiving chemotherapy?
Right. Yeah.
Do you have an appointment in Boston? So we can make sure you don't need to worry about that. We're trying to set it up in our computer so you still can go and it won't be a problem. So a lot of those questions are also to say, hey, wait a minute, do you need a little help with something? You know, you may actually call us and say, you know what, I'm losing my housing in a week.
Yeah.
What do I do? And we do get calls like that.
Right.
How do I get in touch? Do I lose my insurance? What does this mean? Did I lose my insurance? So all those kind of questions we try to answer. But we're really trying to figure out if you need some extra assistance through the process, especially folks who have very sick children or ongoing medical needs. We want to make sure we get everybody connected and you don't worry about getting your services or for your child, and that your doctor doesn't worry about what happens or how do I do this, because very often we need to bridge that gap with all these the staff to make sure the physician as well understands. If they're in Boston, they may not know what the collaborative is.
Right.
We want them to feel assured.
Right. And if I could just highlight, because we are all working together in this, we certainly, all of our offices are going to be encouraging patients and members to please take these calls from Fallon and the other folks who are reaching out, because that's important, because that'll help us to understand what the needs are and how we can help folks as well.
Well, guys, believe it or not, it's time to wrap this up. And for those of you who have been watching the show tonight, you're watching the Berkshire Fallon Health Collaborative this discussion. You're watching the Berkshire Health Program. We've been talking about the Berkshire Fallon Health Collaborative. And again, I want to say thank you to my guests, Mike Nicky, who's the Vice President of Medical Programs for the state, Dr. Everett Lamb, who is Medical Director of CHP. Everett, thank you again. And Tom Consolati, who is an internist in the area and the chairman of our clinical integration committee for our physician health organization. As a way of my saying thank you for you being on the show, I have an extraordinarily expensive gift. This is for your, you can pass this down, Mike. This is for your favorite hot beverage. It should be a healthy choice. I just want to reemphasize that. And keep it in mind that, you know, that's my way of saying thank you. And again, appreciate you coming on the show. For those who've been watching the show tonight, it's been my pleasure to host you. Again, you've been watching the Berkshire Health Program. This is hard, Berkshire Fallon Health Collaborative. Until next time, good night.